There's funds for all the leaders. Leader, let's all change the mind. Change the mind.
We can have some order for a moment. Hi everyone, my name is Jamira McPherson. Thank you all for being here. Today is day one of our homecoming program, cohort two. And I'm just going to quickly repeat, just very briefly, what we're doing here. What we're here to do is decolonize our mind, really and truly. And how we decided to start our conversation is with the most important conversation that we're going to have moving forward. This is going to be the foundation, the bedrock of everything that we do moving forward. So thank you, Jaden, and your crew for coming. Like, you have, well, you're going to learn to know how important this presentation is. Prehistoric Africa. This is Africa untouched. This is Africa not untouched by Africans, but untouched by colonization. This is the foundation. This is the original. This is what everything has been imitating. And understanding this is a crucial, I think it's fundamental to any type of transformation that can ensue within us as well as without us. And with that being said, I feel like there's no further ado. This is Jaden. He is a historian. Like, I honestly want to say that just from speaking to you, and I don't know if you remember me from Sean, bro, this is a while ago.
Not that far back.
Yeah, so like we met like over 10 years ago. Very different circumstances, like we were just hanging out. And it's just beautiful to see how you have evolved and became more of who you are.
Thanks.
A historian at the tender age of 26?
29.
I'm sorry, 29, still tender. This is literally because you do it for the heart of it. There's no other reason. It's not like you're doing this to make money with that sole purpose. You're doing this solely because you care about it. And I feel that's how we keep our traditions alive. That's how we keep our history alive. So thank you. We're very excited to see what you have for us today.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Peace, good day, greetings, and imhotep, everyone. My full name is Jaden Keon Ogé-Maxwell, born in Scarborough, raised in Markham. As Jamira just said, I'm only 29 years young. For the most part, I can honestly and openly say that my first vocation before any of this is that is of a father of two beautiful young children. After that, I'm a plumber. I trained my time and I trained my skills as a plumber with the local 46th Union of Toronto, which is awesome. And on the side, what I would consider my hobbies are diving in and the deep study of fields such as history, anthropology, eschatology, and all things as relates to African history and world as relates to world history. So this based, you know, this all started, I would say, around 2014 when a very good and a very powerful mentor of mine by the name of Victor Bosole saw something in me that compelled him to drop a bag on me. But this bag wasn't money. This bag was of books. And in this bag, I was introduced to the most profound books that I've ever seen in my life. And unless he had given me this bag, I don't know where I would be, if I would be standing where I am today. So first and foremost, I want to acknowledge Victor Bosole. I want to acknowledge the ancestors who I take inspiration from. People like Professor James Small, people like the brothers of Twin Pillars, Red and Blue Pill, people like Brother Polite, people like Runoku Rashidi, Anthony T. Browder, Dr. Joseph Benjamin Yonakinan, Chancellor Williams, Sheikh Anthony Diop, Wallace Budge. These are all people who, with the works I've studied and looked over and devoted my time and energy into diving into. So it is with a great pleasure and honor that I speak these ancestors' names and give respect to where it's due. So today what I want to be doing is a deep dive into pre-colonial and pre-dynastic African history. Pre-colonial meaning before the time that colonization was occurring, or before the time of any inception with any foreigners, as well as pre-dynastic, a time before 3,200 before the Common Era, over 5,000 years ago. So on that note, welcome all to the exploration into pre-colonial and pre-dynastic African culture, a presentation for Catharsis of Toronto. So I'm gonna start this presentation off right and give respect to an elder and start with a profound quote by the late, great Dr. John Henry Clark, 1915 to 1998. He's on record stating, "History is the clock that people use to tell their political and cultural time of day. It is the compass they can use to find themselves on the map of human geography. It is the role of history to tell people where they have been, where they are, and what they are. But most most importantly, it's the role of history to tell our people where they still must go and what they still must be. So, on that note, I ask us all, who are we? Where do we come from? What direction are we going? All right, slide one. We are gonna start, before even getting into the seven elements of culture, I wanna start right off the bat with shaking up our minds and giving us some really concrete, in-depth, critical pieces of information about pre-colonial and pre-dynastic African culture that we simply don't, or we're not taught in school. So for that, I'm gonna start with a quick five-part analysis of prehistoric African history. Now in this slideshow, I'm new at this. As I said, I'm a father and I'm a plumber. This is on the side when I have time. So yeah, you know, just try not to get too carried away. Follow my voice and focus on the pictures. Don't read ahead, don't cheat yourself. There's some bombs here. All right, prehistoric African history. What does that even mean? Just how far back in time does the history of the melanated people go? Well, unfortunately, due to psychological implications of the literary works that came from many of these Western scholars and authorities on African culture, such as in books such as The Golden Age, written in 1929, authors taught that it is generally believed that the curse in which Noah placed on Canaan was the origin of the black race. Certain is it that when Noah said, "Cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall he be unto his brethren," he pictured the future of the colored race. Absurd, is it not? Just how did it come to be that narratives such as these would gain enough traction to find themselves published and taken seriously? I declare that it is a direct result of the fact that African civilization as it existed during its zenith, as well as its history, was wiped out, warped, and all but forgotten. This tragedy, as we know it, is known throughout the dialects of the Kiswahili as the Maafa, which translates into the Great Disaster. Throughout this Great Disaster, enslavers of Africans made it illegal for Africans to read and write. They were forced to beget all they had learned and taught. After 400 years of forgetting, they forgot that they had forgotten. But that changes today. In the words of the great historian, anthropologist, and author Anthony T. Browder, whose works we're going to highlight today and whose timeline we're going to bring out today, Big Up to the Elder, I want to tell us, on that quote, "We will remember for them. We will read for them. We will write for them. We will teach for them. We will make certain that they have never been forgotten again." In order to do that, I'd like to begin this presentation by highlighting five groundbreaking traces of African excellence that they won't teach you in school. Part one, Zinjanthropus buasi, fossil man. When one does an innocent search into the age of the oldest human remains, Google quickly leads you to an article posted by USA Today back on January 16th of 2022, which is fairly recent. And in this article, it reads, "Remains known as Omo the First were found in the southwest Ethiopia in the late 1960s, which suggests that they are approximately only 230,000 years old. However, it should be noted that on July 17, 1959, Doctors Mary and Louis Leakey unearthed the first tool-making hominid in the lower bed of the Old Ubai Gorge in Tanzania. This fossil man was rated to be at least 1.8 million years old by the University of California's new potassium argon method dating. Now, quick side note, for the most part, we use radiocarbon methods of science to date, relics and artifacts and bones. However, when you get further, then I believe it is, don't quote me on it, go check it up, I believe it is around 200,000 years of something being old, you then have to switch into potassium argon dating. So via the potassium-argon dating method of the University of California, Zinjanthropus buasi in the lower bed of the Old Ubai Gorge in Tanzania, 1.8 million years old. Given this information, I've always questioned why we're pointed in the direction of Western Asia's four rivers allegedly flowing out of the Garden of Eden when life, civilization, and all signs and symbols of the primordial man traces back to the Great Lake regions of Central and East Africa. Next slide. Zinjanthropus buasi. So here I'm taking the liberty of showing you a picture of what the Old Ubai Gorge looks like, an aerial. This is where the Old Ubai Gorge is in relation to Kenya, Uganda, Somalia, Rwanda, and Tanzania. Side note, Lake Victoria was originally named Lake Nyanzia. There was no Victoria in pre-colonial Africa. This is a skull of Zinjanthropus buasi. Now, everyone wants to say, "That's a monkey, those are apes." When you look at the palate and the mouth structure, the jaw structure of this prehistoric hominid, you see that it very closely, if not parallels, the palette of the modern day human man. You also see when you read in books just such as Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, that this fossil man had use of tools. This is the first tool-making man. This is not an ape. I dispel all notions that this was an ape. Anyone wants to speak otherwise? Let's have a conversation. Moving on. Part two, the invention of the calendar. Egyptian civilization developed over a long period of time in its early cradle. Then it slowly descended down the Nile Valley to spread out around the Mediterranean basin. This cycle of civilization, the longest in history, presumably lasted over 10,000 years, based on data provided by the Egyptian priests. Herodotus and Manetho placed the beginning of pre-dynastic Egyptian civilization at 17,000 BC. Side note, Abraham doesn't pop in until around, around 1,700 BCE. So pre-dynastic Egyptian and Kemetic Kushite Nubian civilization is almost 10,000 years older than any concept and notions of Abraham. Moving on. And the short chronology of the Nile Valley shows that by the year 4245 before the Common Era, the Egyptians had already invented the calendar, which in itself requires the passage of 1,000 years of cosmic observation. This calendar was found in the Temple of Dendera complex around the Nile Valley. Moving on, the zodiac system of Dendera. Just another, you know, you can't go through the Temple of Dendera without acknowledging the zodiac. The early inhabitants of the Nile Valley identified groups of stars which were stretched across the sky, and those rising followed each by a period of 10 days. These stars were associated with the various gods and called deacons. The division of Kemetic years into 36 weeks of 10 days each meant that each week was ruled over by a specific deacon or constellation. This is the process by which it was determined thousands of years ago that a circle would consist of 360 degrees, 36 by 10 deacons, 360 degrees. The people of Kemet further divided the heavens into 12 divisions in the southern sky, 12 divisions in the northern sky, and 12 divisions in the central sky. These 36 divisions were then divided among the three seasons, and from that delineation emerged the regions of the 12 signs of the zodiac. Each zodiac sign was associated with the deacon who was referred to as one of the watchers of the hours. They were regarded as messengers of the greater gods of Heru himself. Hence the origin of the word horoscope. Mm-hmm. Horoscope. Horus. Moving on.
May I get those two bags over here if you don't mind? The two knapsacks in the back. Thank you.
Part three, the Semliki harpoon and the prehistoric history of the Congo, the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Africans were the first to organize fishing expeditions 90,000 years ago at Katanka.
Thank you.
At Katanka, a region in northeast Congo, Zaire, now Congo, was recovered a finely wrought series of harpoon points, all elaborately polished and barbed. Also uncovered was a tool, equally well-crafted, believed to be a dagger. The discovery suggests the existence of an early aquatic or fishing-based culture that existed throughout the regions of South Africa, or the empire of Monomotapa, as far as 90,000 years ago. And we'll see here on the right, the Semliki harpoon is one of the oldest tools known to mankind and occurs in the natural range of the Ife pygmies, which is a derogatory term and misnomer for the Twa, that suggests the initial aquatic civilization based on fishing. It's no surprise that the Twa Umbuti, who came from the old Dubai Gorge, migrated south and started fishing in the Monomata Empire. We'll go into that later on. Moving forward, part four, mining in Africa. Africans were the first to engage in mining over 43,000 years ago. In 1964, a hermetic mine was found in Swaziland at Bamvu Ridge in Ngwenya mountain range. Ultimately, 300,000 artifacts were recovered, including thousands of stone man-made mining tools. Adrian Boshier, one of the archaeologists on the site, dated the mine to a staggering 43,000 years old. Moving on to a depiction that I got out of Dr. Yosef Benjamin Yonatan's Africa, Mother of Civilization. These are literally screenshot and cropped images out of this book. And what you see is the article posted on February 8, 1970. It is of major importance that one's attention focus on the following article in the New York Times, 1970. This publication deals with the indigenous Africans' mind where they smelted iron thousands of years before any other high culture, or such as Greece. It is also contradicted those Western scholars and authorities on Bantu African civilization who have for generations maintained that Africans knew nothing of iron until the early part of the Christian era, at which time it was introduced by Asian invaders. Once again, I dispel all notions. Anyone has any questions, let's talk about it. Moving on. The Book of the Dead, the Pyramid Emhyru. The African people of the Nile Valley were the first human beings to express a profound belief in a doctrine of everlasting life. They preserved their bodies and dead by a yet undiscovered process of embalming and entombed these bodies in elaborately inscribed funerary monuments. Prayers and litanies played a major role in preparing the soul of the recently deceased and departed for its journey through the underworld, or the Duat, and guaranteed a safe passage to God in the next world. This Book of the Dead was a compilation of the prayers that were inscribed on the walls of the tombs or written on papyri scrolls, which were buried with the dead. These sacred monuments were discovered by grave robbers who violated these tombs in search of fame and glory, and regarded these writings as the Book of the Dead, which is a misnomer and a mistranslation for the Pirit Emhuru, coming forth into day, or coming forth into your higher being or consciousness. No wonder they change it up. Moving on. That takes part of our five-part analysis. So now we've gone through, I don't want to say the meat and potatoes, we've gone through the introduction, and we all get a understanding that a lot of what we've been taught is simply not true. We can get into the body of this presentation, which is the seven elements of culture. So what exactly is culture? You can see it a lot. You can see my red, gold, and green, my Rastafari. You can see my Pan-African tan. You can see my prehistoric Ankh. You can see my locks. My hair is anointed. You can see a lot of culture. As we grow up, we start to edify ourselves into the different social groups that we're drawn to. We start to hear the word used in many ways. Do it for the culture. One time for the culture. That's disrespectful to the culture. I'm representing the culture, which I do very well. So what does that word mean, and how is it so frequently used? Let's take a look at what Wikipedia says as an answer. Culture is an umbrella term which encompasses the social behavior, institutions, and norms found in human societies, as well as the knowledge, beliefs, arts, laws, customs, capabilities, and habits of the individuals in these groups. Culture is often originated from or attributed to a specific region or location. Okay? So we see here a sister with beautiful culture and her anointed hair. We see here Edward Blyden, the actual father of Pan-Africanism. We see the colors of Pan-Africanism, and we immediately, no fault of our own, acknowledge the Honorable Marcus Mosiah Garvey. What most of us don't know is Marcus Mosiah Garvey is on record giving thanks and acknowledging at the works of Edward Blyden, the true father of Pan-Africanism, in regards to his works to bring him into that consciousness. Okay? Moving forward. The first element of culture: social organization, family patterns, and social class. They say, you know what, before we get too far ahead, I'm going to bring up these books, because I'm going to be talking about a lot of books, and I don't like to just talk. So let's do this thing properly if we're going to do this thing.
And how are we right now? Are we good? Yeah.
We'll get into later. All right. Moving on. First element of culture: social organization, family patterns, and social class. In the book Destruction of Black Civilization by Chancellor Williams, we learn a lot of things. This was the first book that brought me into this realm of consciousness and higher realm of thought. This was the first book I read and realized something is going on here. They say it starts at the home. What is the culture of a people without establishing family ties, connection to your lineage, and social organization in a manner that encourages a progressing and thriving community? It is in this first section it will be my pleasure to highlight many critical pre-colonial aspects of Black family patterns and the operation of social class. To do so, I will utilize the publications of a well-known author, Chancellor Williams, Destruction of Black Civilization,
written by Chancellor Williams, as I just mentioned, where we'll get into an in-depth overview of the political theories and principles of the ancient African people through their constitution, as well as the fundamental rights. Who would have thought? The African Constitution, the birth of democracy. In this section, we shall be highlighting the sixth chapters of Chancellor Williams' publication, where we learn of the fundamental values of African people and how the family unit was a critical part of societal structure that served a very distinct purpose in the progression of race. We read, the African Constitution is discussed as a body of fundamental theories, principles, and practices drawn from the customary laws that governed Black African societies from the earliest of times. The first task is to divorce traditional African institutions with those influenced by Asian and European incursions. To do what is truly African in origin and what is in fact either Asian or European or a reflection of any other external influence. It is with this understanding that we're able to lead right into the topic of the creation, operation, unification of what became known as the chiefless states of the African continent. And over here you'll see a lot of different chiefs of different states. For all we know, this could be the Yoruba, that could be the Dogon, that could be the Mali, but they all have the same culture. So we're gonna get into it and we're gonna see just how similar and how parallel these cultures are and how they keep on based on respect due to lineage and cultural ties. The political theories and principles of ancient African people, the constitutional law and fundamental rights. This is drawn from the African tradition and constitution, customary laws, which different versions and modifications of the same laws occurred in different societies. Who would have thought that pre-colonial Bantus or Hottentots or Africans south of the Sahara could operate in a manner where they had fundamental political laws and oversight over the community? Let's look at how important these things were to our ancestors. Number one, the people are first and the final source of all power. The rights of the community of people are superior to those of any individual. Kings, chiefs, and elders are leaders, not rulers. They are elected to represent the people and the instructions for executing their will. Well, I'm going to go through most of them, not all, for time reasons. Government and people are one of the same. The family is recognized as the primary social, judicial, economic, political unity in the family. Pay attention to number six. It's going to be very important. The land belongs to no one. It is God's gift to mankind for use of sacred heritage. Listen to this. Imagine this in 2023. Each family has a right to land, free of charge, sufficient in acreage for its economic well-being. But a bungalow's 1.4 million right now. Right? Let's put that into perspective. I want to make that very clear. Moving over. The right to equal protection of the law. The right to a home. The right to a home. The right to family or community in care in cases of sickness or accidents. But now we're shipping off Granny's old home because she has Alzheimer's. How far have we come? The right to an apprentice training for a useful vocation. So not the right to go rack up 60 bands in OSAP, the right to an apprenticeship for a vocation, go make something of yourself. That is your God-given right. This is the way our ancestors thought. So once again, any notions, any assumptions, assertions of these Hottentots, Bantus, N-words, African South of the Sahara being an uncivilized people is dispelled. Let's talk about it. These constitutional principles and practices were held onto and carried by the migrating Black to every part of the African continent. This fact is one of the most remarkable because even these societies that sank to barbarism held onto the fundamental age after in which through they were clutching the last threads of itself. Even in Egypt, or Kemet, where the Asian and European impact was the greatest, African constitutionalism could not and would not be blotted out. This came from Destruction of Black Civilization, Chancellor Williams, page 175. Moving forward, second element of culture, democratic nature of the chiefless states. Among the pre-colonial Africans, democratic institutions evolved and functioned in a socio-economical and political system which Western writers call stateless societies or societies without chiefs. It would be known that African democracy originated, in fact, in the same chiefless states who operated just fine without one man as its executive or prime minister or president, and that democracy reached its highest development here where the people actually governed themselves, sovereignty.
without chiefs, where the self-government was a way of life and law and order were taken for granted. The basic structural outline of these states remained the same throughout Africa. The amazing thing was and is uniformity. Amazing how the most basic elements of ancient black civilization could have been held on continent-wide by all these dispersed and isolated groups in spite of continuing impact of unimaginable forces of destruction. The lineage ties and responsibilities and the age grade or age set system were the earliest institutions through which the African constitutions functioned and out of which democracy was born. It was the network of kinsmen and alleged kinsmen and all whom descended from the same ancestor or related ancestors, the Twa'umbuti. All might live in the same community or state, but they were often scattered far and near separate independent societies. So I wanted to put more pictures in, but a lot of these empires are so big, it'll take it up. So, but just to show you a few, this is the Empire of Mali, the region of the Empire of Mali, all the way from West Africa to Songhai. So the suggestion here, what I'm declaring, what my premise is the same community of the Mandinka and the community of these Africans over here by Songhai operated in the same manner. This is the kingdom of Cuba, closer to the Congo and Central Africa. Principal cities and boundaries. So there are principal cities scattered around Cuba. Ngongo, Nesheng, Sheba, all of these. Chiefless states, societies, not states, all operating on the same lineage ties, fundamental right of people, with the same fundamental laws. Moving forward, youth organization and early education. In pre-colonial Africa, the age grade or age shed was the specific organizational structure through which the society functioned. Classification was determined by period in which one was born. All persons born in the same year or within a general but well-defined period before or after a given year belonged in the same age grade. Each grade covered a block of years. Grade 1 might include all children up to age 12, grade 2, 13 to 18, grade 3, 19 to 28, grade 4, 29 to 40, grade 5, 40 onward, then you're an elder. The interlocking responsibilities of the various grades accounted for the smooth functioning of the chiefless states. Each grade had its own social, economic, and political role. The children's set covered the years of game and play. Around the age of 6 and 7, however, general training and some little jobs began to be mingled with play. Primary education included storytelling, mental arithmetic, community songs and dances, learning the names of various birds and animals, the identification of poisonous snakes, local plants and trees, how to run and climb swiftly when pursued by dangerous animals. Destruction of Black Civilization, page 166. Moving on. Second age grade, the intermediate period. Little chores around the house became routine, such as gathering sticks of wood for fuel, bringing water, tending to the cattle, feeding the chickens. The younger girls of the community would naturally gravitate towards looking after a baby, or younger ones, imitating mother at cooking, and trying to learn how to sew and knit. The nearest thing to the young boy's political role in childhood was when he carried his father or uncle to the village council meeting and listened to the intermingled debates. The next grade above childhood was teenage through 18. Now, both training and responsibilities were stepped up. Playtime was either over or very much limited. Education and training became more complex and extensive. The youth's entire future depended upon their performance at this age level. Young men began to be tasked with learning his extended family history and that of his society. The geography of the region, names of neighboring states, and nature of the relationships with them. The handling of weapons, hunting as skilled arts, rapid calculation, clearing the bush for planting, military tactics, bartering tactics, etc. The apprenticeship system in which one became a skilled craftsman was one of the most important of the second level age set activities. This is another reason why the age grade was the most crucial of all. At its end, one went through the initiation rites for the exalted level of manhood. Page 177. Moving over, this is gonna be a good one. The matrilineal origins of pre-colonial Africa, hereditary monarchy. I am happy to stand here and say, regardless of how much of a man I am, I want to say we've come very far, because we live in a world where we're told that women need permission from their men to go and have a girl's trip. We're told that women do not have a voice for the most part. For the most part, there has been a direct attack on divine femininity and the importance of the divine feminine role in the world. Now we're gonna speak on it. To effectively close out the first section of the seven elements of culture, I'd like to speak on the matrilineal origins of pre-colonial Africa and Kemet, and social structure was ruled by a method of dynastic rulership known as hereditary monarchy. Hereditary monarchy is a form of government and succession of power in which the throne passes from one member of the ruling family to another member of the same family. A series of rulers from the same family would constitute a dynasty, Wikipedia. Let it be known that Africans were the first people of the world to appoint a woman as head of state, over 440 years before any concept of Abraham, what wandered into Canaan and Northeast Africa, and that not only were there other female rulers, but every other male pharaoh or sultan or negus or nagu had to take the throne by marrying a particular woman. Let it be known. So when we talk about women and we feel comfortable telling them their place, let it be known. Queen Nitocris, female ruler of the last of the sixth dynasty, 2100 BC. Let's talk about Queen Amos Nefertari, the perfect black. Black was seen as deification in ancient Kemet. To be seen as black is the highest form of respect. Queen Tai, Queen Candace isn't even on here. Queen Hatshepsut, is she? Queen Hatshepsut, she's here. Make sure you pay homage to Queen Hatshepsut. One thing, fun fact. This process here of hereditary monarchy and showing a progressive time span of history, over a thousand years. Keep in mind, in the Bible, we're told that the flood of Noah happened via the annals of the Old Testament. The flood of Noah would have happened around 2300 BC, okay? And that would have wiped out human civilization, right? So why didn't human civilization wipe out? Did the flood skip Kemet? What happened? I have questions, and to this day, I don't have answers. If anyone has an answer to that, let me know. Let's talk about it. Moving on. The matrilineal system is the base of the social organization in Kemet and throughout Black Africa. In contrast, there has never been any proof of the existence of Paleo-Mediterranean matriarchy. Succession to the throne is regulated in Nigeria by matriarchy. We are told that the Queen of Dara had a saddle ox. This reminds us of the customs of the ancient Libyan Garamites. So we might again encounter ancient Caucasian Africans with its matriarchy system. Closely related are the peoples of Sudan and Nubia, the Maronic Sudan, Kush and Nubia, including Teda, Tuareg, as well as the sovereigns of the regions of the Sudan. What is the origin of African matriarchy? We do not know for certain at the present time. However, the current opinion holds that the matriarchal system is related to farming. If agriculture was discovered by women, as it sometimes is thought, if it be true that they were the first to think of selecting nourishing herbs, that this would explain why the woman of the house would be in charge of the food, which no one, not even a big strong husband, can touch without her consent. Frequently, a husband within reach of food prepared by his own wife doesn't dare touch it without her consent. This excerpt is coming by out of Shikandi Diop's African Origin of Civilization, page 142. Look at Queen Hatshepsut. Look at the descendant of Queen Candace, the believed descendant of Queen Candace. Now, a little bit of context. When you see any rulers, such as Narmer, such as this beloved black queen, holding the head of what seems to be numerous peoples, this is with swords in her hands, dual wielding like a warrior, this is letting us know that women picked up swords. They weren't afraid to get down and dirty, and when incursions were happening, like that of the 17th century BC, like that of the 14th century BC and 12th century BC, and we're gonna talk about it, women were on road, holding it down, let it be known. Queen Candace is said to have stopped Alexander the Great at the border of a particular cataract during the 3rd century BC on elephants, and she gave him an opportunity, step forward. He chose otherwise. I would have too. Big up to the queens. Third element of culture, language. Language is said by some to be one of the most important, if not the most important aspect of a people's culture. It is with language that we are able to communicate with one another on a human level. Express thought to read, to write, and most importantly, all in my opinion, to write and to document. In this portion of the presentation,
I will highlight aspects of the world's oldest known writing systems, which were birthed out of the use of what's known as ideograms, which developed into a highly spiritual and sophisticated writing system known as Medu-Nature, which literally translates to tongue of God or the writing of God. Pardon me. To be properly introduced to these ancient Kemetic writing systems, we will highlight a passage out of Nile Valley contribution to civilization, which I don't have handy, and that's on me, I'll get it later. A Nile Valley contribution to civilization. Medu-Nature, the oldest form of writing, was developed in the upper regions of the Nile Valley, and by 3000 before the Common Era, it was being used in ancient Kemet. These early signs specified the consonants in symbols, and so and vowels were written. The Semites developed the alphabet around 1500 before the Common Era, and they also wrote without vowels. And then keep in mind, they also wrote without vowels. The next slide is going to be context. Okay? In an attempt to stress the originality of the Semitic alphabet, the Word Book of Encyclopedia states, historians can find no instances where the Semites borrowed the characters from Egyptian writing. I'm going to say that again. The World Book Encyclopedia states, historians can find no instances where the Semites borrowed the characters from Egyptian writing, right? They invented their own set of characters to stand for the consonants and their languages. However, upon examination, one will find that every character in the Semitic alphabet is identical to those that came from Kemet. In fact, even the meanings are the same. Now, by the contributions to the civilization, page 179. Now, some context, this is some ideograms. Instead of ideograms can be found in more central regions of Africa, 9000 BC. This is Tehuti, known as Thoth to the Greeks. Tehuti, the scribe of the Netcher, and the deity which represents wisdom and knowledge, also represents by the ibis or the baboon. The reason why Tehuti is represented by ibis in an anthropomorphic and in a zoomorphic perspective is because the ibis bird burrows its head underground in search for food and pulls food out of the ground. So what's that? Bringing from what's in darkness to light, bringing what you don't know to what you know. This is the way the Kemetics thought symbolically. Wisdom, subscribe, scientist, judgment, and he would write down the weighing of the souls. This is a picture of Tehuti as a hieroglyphic form, and some more Medu-Nature for you. So once again, the Semitic alphabet has nothing to do with the Kemetic alphabet, right? Boom, let's get into it. The Kemetic origins of the Roman alphabet. Let's talk about it. The next significant writing system emerged around 1000 BCE, and it was developed by a people who, like the Semites, also lived along the coast of the Mediterranean Sea. They were called Phoenicians, and the alphabet was similar to the ones developed by the Kemetic people and the Semites. The Phoenician alphabet contained only consonants and lacked vowels, like I said. While the characters of the Phoenician alphabet were marked differently from the Semitic and Kemetic, their meaning were similar in as many aspects. So let me explain what we're seeing here. We're seeing that in the Kemetic alphabet, an ox head was changed into an ox in the Semitic alphabet, was changed into an ox in the Phoenician alphabet, which was changed into alpha in Greek, and then A in Rome. It's pretty clear. Twisted rope, rope, H, eta, H. This is stuff that we should know. If I was a 13-year-old kid and someone taught me this, what? Mouth, P, mouth, curvature, pi, P. Snake, nun, S, et, nu, N. So once again, I don't know if I'm missing something here, but I think this is significant. I think this is something that we should be talking about. Moving on. Prehistoric proto-writing systems of South Africa. Once again, the ancient Mundumotapa Empire. The purpose of writing has always been to communicate ideas. Africans have been doing this for at least 100,000 years in the form of engravings, such as those uncovered in the Bolombos Cave in South Africa. Such engravings would later evolve into so-called proto-writing, or identifiable symbols that were used to convey information, but are not known to be a part of language. University of Bordeaux researchers in Daegu, South Africa, found 60,000-year-old eggshells with symbolic patterns that are believed to communicate the names of local communities. This is one of the eggshells. Now, National Geographic knows what it is. They know what's going on over there. They're out there making their
theories and you know, making their assumptions as to what's happening. We don't know what's going on, but National Geographic does. This stuff needs to be common knowledge. This is a picture of the interior of the Bulombos Cave, South Africa. And this is a depiction out of Dr. Joseph Benjamin Yinakinan's Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, which I just finished, 692 pages, biggest book I've ever read. And what you see here is, once again, it's not a secret how caves in the Bulombos Cave, South Africa, how did they have information so old? Once again, the Twa Umbuti migrated, just as they migrated to Yoruba and then became the Yoruba, just as they migrated and became the Kemites, just as they migrated and became the Nagas in Asia. Let's talk about it. Home of the Pygmies. Once again, they're not Pygmies, they're the Twa. The Twa Umbuti. Regardless of Bush, but now they're called Bushmen, Hottentots, south of the Sahara. I dispel any and all notions. Let's have a conversation. This one is gonna be good. Fourth element of culture, religion. It should be needless to say that an imperative aspect of culture worth noting of any era would be how a civilization of people related to, interpreted, described, and engaged with their cosmic surroundings in order to identify and relate to a divine force that encompasses all things around us. Some would describe this as the study of God. Theology, religion, spirituality, etc. It is very unfortunate that due to modern academia, these terms and their origins are rarely ever associated with the indigenous Africans of the Nile Valley. For it is due to the assertions and declarations of Western scholars that have led us to believe that any and all contributions of significance which were birthed on the African continent were strictly a result of the accomplishments of the sons of Noah. And there's actually a theory that was created called the Hamitic Hypothesis, which suggests that any and everything out there that's sick has nothing to do with the Hottentots and Bushmen and African South Sahara. Only the sons of Noah, the Hamites. I'm dispelling, I want to have a conversation. I'm dispelling notions upon notions, okay? Sons of Noah, and had nothing to do with the African people. I am here to dispel that myth and clarify the misconception. So on that note, in what's bound to be a jam-packed portion and the biggest portion of this presentation, we are about to do an in-depth analysis on the religious system and spiritual compository of the Nile Valley and demonstrate how their contributions influence Western religion systems around the world. What we're looking at is inside the tomb of the mortuary temple of Merneptah, where he had to, and Merneptah was the pharaoh that was one of the last pharaohs that had to shut down what I believe was the fourth coalition of Indo-Europeans and Indo-Aryans who tried to run up in the line. So as you can see, this is a very significant mortuary temple where a lot of the Medu Netcher, a lot of the Tongue of God, and a lot of the eschatology, meaning study of life after God, and a lot of the eschatological scripture is written down. This is going to be an exciting presentation. Moving on. Theology, the origins of the study of God. Before we get ahead of ourselves, let's lay our groundwork. What does this term theology really mean? What is its origin? And where can it be traced to? When one studies the Encyclopedia Britannica, we learn the study of the nature of God and religious belief, i.e. religious belief and theory, were systemically developed. That is what the term is. Just how far back in time can we trace the first records of man studying the nature of God? When one looks into the history of pre-dynastic and pre-colonial Africa, i.e. Kemet, we learn that the tale of Asar was the earliest recorded story of a god-man who was symbolically crucified, resurrected from death, and reigned eternally in heaven. This tale dates back at least to 4,700 before the Common Era.
Wow.
3,000 years before Abraham.
Wow.
4,000 odd years before the birth of Yeshua the Christ. You'll find I'll do my best to use a word that more appropriate is associated with this divine creator. There was no J's back then, so I'm gonna say Yeshua, okay? The people of the Nile Valley believed that they lived righteously in harmony with the teachings of Asar. They would inherit eternal life. In the Nile Valley, he became a powerful symbol and was associated with the physical and spiritual rebirth of man.
So you'll see Asar, who's also pictured sometimes like with green, because that shows that he's in touch with Geb and the aspect and representation of Earth. He has the white crown, which I believe was the Deshet of Upper Kemet. This is Asar, once again, the white crown, sitting with the Aeneid and going through a process and the judgment of the Maat system. And this is, once again, Asar being given what it looks like life. And Het Heru, I got my Het Heru going on today. All right, moving forward. Holy Trinity, the royal family of Kemet. Asar was the most celebrated of the Netcheru in all of Kemet. It has been written that at the time of his birth, a voice was heard to proclaim that the Lord of Creation was born. Asar was recognized as the great king of Kemet, who brought civilization to his people and established a code of laws and instructions for the worship of God. He ruled Kemet along with his wife Aset, who is better known by her Greek name Isis. According to the legend, Asar was slain by his cunning brother Set, who cut his body into 14 pieces and scattered them throughout Kemet. After a long search, Aset found all the parts of her husband's body, except his phallus, which legend has it was consumed by a catfish when it was discarded into the Nile. Aset created the missing member of Asar in the form of a tekken, known as an obelisk, to represent an erected phallus. Okay? Which later became a symbol representing the resurrection of Asar.
Resurrect.
Moving on. Aset was without child before the murder of Asar, but by means of certain powerful words given to her, Aset conceived a child upon being immaculately impregnated by the spirit of her husband, Asar. That excerpt came out of Nile Valley Contributions to Civilization, page 89. I have no reason. I gain nothing by suggesting that these are my thoughts. This is the work of our elders, and I am bringing it forth. That's what the ancient Ghanaian concept of Sankofa is. I went back and fetched it, and look what I brought for you. Page 89. Go look it up for yourself. This is the depiction of the ancient Trinity: man, woman, child, Asar, Aset, Heru. Everyone has a rightful place on the throne. And keep in mind, once again, talking about the matrilineal origins. Do you see Aset behind Asar? No, she's beside him. She's of equal importance. There is no trinity without a divine woman creator. Earth is a circular or oval-like shape. That is a feminine shape. Moving on. The African origin of an immaculate conception and virgin birth. The story of Asar, Aset, and Heru is the first story in recorded history of man of a royal family, the Trinity. Immaculate conception, virgin birth, and resurrection. Evidence of this trinity is known to have existed in ancient Nubia, Ethiopia, as late as 3,300 before the Common Era. Like, I want to make that very clear. Thousands of years before Abraham, we have the Immaculate Conception carved into our walls. In this uncarving, what you'll see are all four things: the Annunciation, the Netra Jehuti is shown announcing to the Virgin Aset coming birth of her son. Two, the Immaculate Conception. The Netra Neph, who represents the Holy Ghost, and Het Heru Hathor with the sun, symbolically impregnating Aset by holding Ankh, the symbol of life, to her nose, where you breathe in life, right? Nostrils, Virgin Mother to be. Number three, bam, the virgin birth. Aset is shown sitting on the birthing stool, and the newborn child is attended by midwives. Four, the adoration. The newborn hero, is portrayed receiving gifts from the three kings or three magi while being adorned by the hosts of gods and men. Why is this not in our school systems? This is critical. The Grand Lodge of Luxor served as one of the main centers of education in which theological training of the Memphite theology was conducted. It has been estimated that at the time, there were more than 80,000 students at all grade levels studying at the temples of Luxor and Karnak, or the Ipet Isut, and southern Ipet. Temples were at the centers of religion, politics, and education. The faculty were called the Herseta, or teachers of the mysteries, and were divided into departments which are as follows. One, mystery teachers of the heavens, which studied astronomy and astrology. Teachers of the lands, geography. Teachers of depths, geology, teachers of the secret word, philosophy and theology, pharaoh and mystery teachers, law and communion. Now, Valley Contributions to Civilization, page 95. Moving on. Grand Lodge of Luxor. Things are about to start getting interesting. The Grand Lodge of Luxor, the Egyptian mystery systems. Much has been written about the mystery schools of the Nile Valley, but one important factor must be remembered. These schools and the subjects taught within them were a mystery only to those who were unfamiliar with the system of education. The purpose of education in the Nile Valley was to create a society where the citizens would understand the relationship which extended between themselves, the creator, and the surrounding cosmos. In the sense of the word, the education centers in the Nile Valley were the first universities. Upon closer examination of the complexities of the Nile Valley education, one can begin to understand why they were called mystery schools by the many foreigners who came seeking enlightenment. The Grand Lodge of Luxor, which is where the word luxurious came from, was built at Dendera by the pharaoh Khufu during the Third Dynastic era. This area is presently called Lower Egypt or Lower Kemet. It is also known as the Temple of Ancient Thebes. The measurement of said structure were 2,000 feet long by 1,000 feet at its base. The ancient Greeks, including Herodotus, visited this institution for the basic and advanced training in philosophy, religion, engineering, history, medicine, etc. This is a combination of excerpts coming out of Africa, Mother of Western Civilization, as well as now by the contributions to civilization. Combo. All right? These are the columns of Luxor. I'll give you a better one just now, but this is a short aerial view of the Temple of Luxor. The thing is, this isn't hocus pocus stuff. I do think. Pull it up on your Google. You're going to see it for yourself. This is the entrance to the Grand Lodge of Luxor. So how is it that architecture has reached such a zenith thousands of years before any concept of Abraham, and we're not being told about it? Moving on. As I said, Google Earth, view of the Grand Lodge of Luxor. You can see the megalithic structure, the solar structure. Now keep in mind, I'll give you some context later, but it is said that just as the mortuary temple of Hatshepsut during the winter equinox, on the morning of the 25th, when the sun, S-U-N, not S-O-N, was born, the priest would create this megalithic structure so that the sun would beam directly in here into the Holy of Holies. This is a mastery of architecture, astrology, cosmology, theology, and an application of knowledge. Let it be known. Some of the subordinate lodges of ancient Egyptian mystery systems. The curriculum of the Egyptian mystery system that spread throughout the ancient world came directly from Osira, the Grand Lodge of Luxor. All other lodges, including those in Asia and Europe, received their instructions from the subordinate lodges in Egypt. Some of the most important lodges of foreign note were the Ionian Temple, the Megara Temple, and the Crotona Temple, and the Delphi Temple. Some of the subordinate lodges are listed: Mount Carmel, which is in Palestine, Mount Lebanon in Syria, Media near the Red Sea, Babylon around the Tigris and Euphrates valleys, the Ganges Lodge in India, Burma, the Athenian Lodge in Greece, Rome, Croton, and Delphi. So just to put it in context, all of these lodges of higher forms of education that are being scattered around Western Asia and Asia Minor are taking instructions from the African priests of the Nile Valley. Let it be known. Note, it should be noted that there is historical records that shows that King Solomon, as well as Yeshua the Christ, attended a subordinate lodge called Mount Carmel, where each was initiated and served their apprenticeship. Gnostic texts, such as the first apocalypse of James, were likely banned due to their different understanding of Yeshua the Christ's importance. They understood Yeshua much more in terms of being a revealer of human wisdom. These findings were produced by a man by the name of Brent Lando, who was a religious studies lecturer at the University of Texas at Austin, who presented these findings at the Society of Biblical Literature annual meeting in Boston in November 2017. So this isn't an assumption, this isn't something that you're hearing on the streets of 125th in Harlem. This is coming from some real scholarly people. These assertions are coming from people who know what they're talking about. Okay, that's why I'm bringing up their names. If you read the Apocrypha text, you will read that Yeshua was a student of the mystery systems and that he traveled to Tibet and India, where he learned energetic healing as well as meditation. Now, some of this information is coming out of the Compendium of the Emerald Tablets by Billy Carson. Phenomenal read. And this is another combo excerpt. Yosef Benjamin Nakinan, Billy Carson. Get the books. Okay, moving on. Curriculum of the Egyptian mystery systems.
When we examine the holy orders of Egypt, the Egyptian mystery systems, it is soon discovered that the priests were subjected to an exact methodology of an education that required at least 40 to 47 years of seclusive studies of a curriculum which allowed nothing short of total devotion. Within the lodges of the priesthood, these studies could cover the entire scope of the Memphite theology, which included cosmology, philosophy, theology, astrology, social science, and the seven liberal arts. I don't know, I wanted to, you know, dive into Stolen Legacy by George G.M. James and really give an in-depth perspective and an analysis of the Memphite theology and the need and how the Memphite theology is associated with modern science, but way too much. That's the next time. These practices led the initiates towards the cleansing of their soul for its entrance into heaven. All subordinate lodges were eventually destroyed by the early beginnings of the Christian era as a direct result of the edicts of the Roman emperors Theodosius and Justinian because of their fear that the African mystery system would have outlasted their new religion, Christianity. Yet before the destruction of these temples, those emperors, I'm gonna say this, keep in mind, before the destruction of these temples, these emperors made certain that their soldiers and overseers made their scribes copy eschatological and spiritual concepts and adopted them into the new religion, Christianity. So a little bit of context, a little bit of buzzword. This is groundbreaking. So you're telling me for thousands of years, the African indigenous Africans of the Ainu race, of the Ta'umbuti, had the first signs and symbols of primordial man and spirituality thousands of years ago. And then old Roman Emperor Theodosius and Justinian comes and says, nah, nice all of that. Close that all down. Our religion's running things now. I'm not making any statements. All I'm saying is that's critical. Very, 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 very critical as to how a new religion, which was birthed during the Nicene Conference of the 3rd century, all of a sudden spread throughout the world. They eradicated any and all competition. Why would these emperors want people having access to texts like the Coffin Text, the Book of Gates, the Pyramid Text, where people could see the parallels between the two texts? They wouldn't want that. Shut those down. Close that all out. I'm going to show you today. Moving forward. The African influence throughout the Hebrew Bible. Over the years, many have made claims that various aspects of African spiritual concepts found their way into and throughout the Hebrew Bible. Without appropriate evidence, these are very bold claims to make. In this portion of the presentation, I'd like to provide information and context and allow the viewers to come to their own conclusion as to whether or not that statement is true. To do that, I'd like to start right at the beginning with a few narratives coming out of the Pentateuch, or the Pentateuch, also known as the five books of Moses. It is important to note that we are taught that the five books of Moses were written down by Moses at divine dictation directly from God. Moses went up to Mount Sinai, end of the 4th century BCE, got the message from God, so there's no middleman. So there's no reason why we should be finding parallel literature and scripture, eschatological scripture, in different narratives, right? Let's see. Boom! Gate quote, the pyramid text in the Bible. The pyramid texts, which are the oldest spiritual texts known to mankind, were carved into the walls of the Pyramid of Unas during the 5th dynastic era of Kemet, 2465 before the Common Era. These ancient texts were combined with other writings found in numerous coffins and tombs and incorporated into a body of work which is known throughout the world as the Peret Emheru, which translated into the Book of Coming Forth by Day, also called the Book of the Dead, also called the Book of the Dead. There are a number of significant religious references which have emerged from the pyramid texts and the Book of Coming Forth by Day. They include the conception of heaven, the soul of man going to heaven, the soul of man sitting on the throne by the side of God, the heavenly blessed eating from the tree of life, God molding man from clay, God breathing the breath of life into man's nostrils, just like we saw carved in Luxor 3,000 years ago, right? The concept of creation through the spoken word, moral concept of good and evil, and traditions of hell. Now Body Contributions to Civilization, page 88, Anthony T. Browder, shout out to the elder. So this is literally a picture of these pyramid texts which we're going to really go into them with some literature from Shaka Atmos, who I'm glad I brought his book today. And you can see, these are writings, eschatological scripture that predate Abraham by almost 700 years. Picture the pyramid of Unas. Once again, this isn't hocus pocus. This isn't skip to my loo. Look it up. These things are still erected today. Codex game over. The New Testament on trial. Game time. It's time for a comparative analysis between the scripture coming out of the New Testament Holy Bible and the ancient spiritual utterances that were found carved onto the walls of the Temple of Unas during the Old Kingdom of Kemet. The author of this publication, an independent research specialist, Shaka Atmos, shout out to Shaka Atmos, demonstrates the lengths to which the editors of the New Testament took direct influence from the literary depository of the Africans of the Nile Valley civilizations. How? Maybe because there were two edicts from Theodosius and Justinian that gave their soldiers free rein at running up in the temple, getting their things, and now they got a New Testament. Fascinating. Which predated the entrance of the first Hebrew into the land of Canaan by over 800 years. Shaka Atmos with the side lock representing prince and high royalty. Shout out to Shaka Atmos and the House of Consciousness. Moving forward, who's ready? Bam! Comparative analysis. Pyramid text, 2465 BCE and Old and New Testament. Let's take a look. Utterances 412-732b. That will be born again. John chapter 3:7. You must be born again. Utterances 388-681a. Heru is risen. Now Christ is risen, thousands of years later. Utterances 257 verse 305a. He sits on the throne of the Lord of all. Jesus Christ, Lord of all. Acts 10:36. Look it up. Utterances 519. They give to the end the tree of life. Genesis 3:22. In the Pentateuch, in the first books of the Bible, right out of the gate. Plagiarism is an idea, and I'm not calling anyone a plagiarizer. All I'm saying is if you look up plagiarism, what you're going to find is if someone takes something and presents it like it's their own, hey man, all I'm saying. Utterances 685, the waters of life are in the sky. Book of Revelations, chapter 21, 5-7. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Utterances 5:11-1:15. Parts of heaven open the doors of heaven. Psalm 78:23. Yet he gave a command to the skies above and opened the doors of heaven. Is it just me, or are we on to something? Utterances 461-872c. Heru, the Lord of heaven. Acts 17:24. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven. And the last one, King of kings, right? Sometimes people say, if King of kings is associated with anyone aside from Yeshua the Christ, people are getting crazy. What? Papyrus of Ani, Hamash Adib, King of kings, Lord of lords, Prince of princes. And then years after the fact, Greco-Roman Judeo-Christian narrative, First Book of Timothy, 6:15, which God will bring about in his own time, God, the blessed and the only ruler, King of kings, Lord of lords. What I'm here to say is the word origin means something. Chronology means something. The definition of plagiarism means something. These things, circumstantial evidence is when you have so much evidence of something you don't really need anymore. Unless I'm missing something, I am dispelling any and all notions that the Hebrew Bible, Old Testament, and New Testament did not take direct influence with the spiritual repository that they found in the temples of Kemet. Moving on. Woo! Conclusive statements. As we close out this exciting portion of the presentation, there are a few critical pieces of information that we should all take home with us. First being, Matthew chapter 2, 3:13-23 says, teaches us that as a child, Yeshua the Christ was taken into Egypt to remain hiding until the death of Herod. Now, I'm not going to say anything, but I like asking questions. And the question I have is, how well would a fair-skinned Indo-European or Indo-Aryan child do hiding in the land of the blacks, Kemet, if he was the only way to lock it around? It wouldn't really work that well. It doesn't make sense. Moving on. The Gospel of the Holy Twelve. The Gospel of the
Holy Twelve, found in Tibet, a Tibetan monastery, by a reverend, teaches us that while Yeshua the Christ was in Egypt, he learned all the wisdom of the Egyptians, just as Moses did, as described in Acts 7:22. What wisdom did he learn? We're not going to go into it, but I'll talk about how in the Compendium of the Emerald Tablets of Creation were hid in the halls of Amenti by the great dweller of ancient Kemet. And in the Compendium of the Emerald Tablets, you'll see a lot of the same parallels, just like I'm doing here, as you do in the New Testament. So what does it mean that Yeshua the Christ was educated in the Egyptian mystery systems? And what does it mean that he had all the wisdom just as Moses did? And then what does it mean that a lot of the things that he said, the Kemet said? I think I'm onto something. Africa was naturally among the first areas to which Christianity spread, due to it being right next door to Palestine. Big up Palestine, bro. Four, the Coptic Ethiopian community of Christians, first century CE, were among the first to spread the gospel throughout the land and portrayed Yeshua the Christ as they encountered him during his travels as a dark-skinned, pigmented man. You go to the Library of Alexandria, and you'll see, in the first century, 200 years before Constantine gathered the 300 bishops and decided how they're going to manipulate the Bible, Yeshua was painted as a pigmented man. What does that mean? You tell me. The popular Eurocentric version of Yeshua the Christ was commissioned and painted by the famous Leonardo da Vinci in the likeness of a man by the name of Caesar Borgia, or Borgia, who was the son of Pope Alexander VI. Godfrey Higgins, an English historian from the 17th century, or 500 years ago, an English historian published in his works by the name of the Anacalypsis that Yeshua the Christ was originally depicted to be a black man of Ethiopian origin. Hey, this isn't rhetoric, man. These things are documented, man. 500 years ago, man, it's not new. Godfrey Higgins, 1772 to 1833. I don't have his book here with me. Next time you see me, I will. In very ancient as well as modern times, the worship of a female supposed to be a virgin with an infant in her arms has prevailed. This worship has not been confined to one particular place of country, but has spread to nearly every part of the habitable world. In all Romish countries to this day, the Virgin with the infant Jesus Christ in her arms is the favorite object of adoration. And it is, as it has been observed before, a decorative proof that the Christ, the Good Shepherd, the Savior of the Romish Church of Italy, is the same as the person, is the same person of the same name in India, and that he, like him, is described to be black, to be Ethiopian. That's how he was able to be hidden in Egypt. Anacalypsis, page 303, 500 years ago. This is not new stuff. But wait a minute. Wasn't the Virgin Mary always depicted as a fair-skinned woman? Which would subsequently make Yeshua the Christ also a fair-skinned male by default, I assume, correct? I said the Black Madonna and Child, origin of the Virgin Mary. Let's get into it. A woman by the name of Jocelyn Rhines, author of Shaken Creeds, The Virgin Birth Doctrine, has thoroughly researched the history of the virgin birth stories and discussed their African origin. She is on record stating that Horus, or Heru, was said to be the parthenogenesis child of the Virgin Mother, Isis. In the catacombs of Rome, black statues of this Egyptian divine mother and infant still survive from the early Christian worship of the Virgin and Child, to which they are converted. In these, the Virgin Mary is represented as a black negress. So if the first statues and relics of the Virgin Mary represented Yeshua the Christ's mother as a negress, by default, I would assume Yeshua the Christ was a Negro in some way, shape, or form. Now, contributions to civilization, page 97. And as you can see, Asat and Heru, the first depiction of a divine mother and child, which was transformed into the Black Madonna and Child of the earliest of Christian times. And even before the Virgin Mary, there's Theotokos. There is an Ethiopian representation of a Virgin Mary named Theotokos that was actually a Virgin Mary
before this Virgin Mary we see here. These things are very important. Moving forward, the worship of Isis and Horus as the Black Madonna and Child was widespread throughout Southern Europe up until the convening of the Nicene Council around 332 AD. After that meeting, the images of the African born Aset and Heru became European in appearance, and their names were changed to Mary and Jesus. Despite this action, many churches in Europe continue to secretly worship the Black Madonna and Child. There are shrines of the Black Madonna in Italy, Spain, and Russia, and currently, whenever Pope John Paul II visits the shrines of Częstochowa in his native land, Poland, he often prays at the feet of a Black Madonna. So in our face, we are comfortable putting women down, but behind closed doors, you're kissing her feet. Let it be known. It is clear that the early Christians bestowed some of the Isis. Wallace Budge, former keeper of Egyptian and Assyrian antiquities at the British Museum, described the similarities between Isis and Mary in volume 2 of his book, The Gods of Egypt. It is clear that the early Christians bestowed some of Isis's attributes upon the Virgin Mary. There is little doubt that in her character of loving and protecting the mother, she appealed strongly to the imagination of all Eastern peoples among who her cult name, or who her cult came, and that the pictures and sculptures wherein she's represented, in fact, act of suckling on her child Horus, form the foundations for the Christian figures and painting of the Black Madonna and Child. Now, vital contribution to civilization, page 190. And what do we say about the Pope? Paying homage, showing respect to where it's due. They know what's going on. You think the hip hop industry would weaponize sex and weaponize femininity in the way they have if they weren't trying to hide something? Nothing is done by accident. Someone said in politics, nothing is done by accident. It's not an accident that people like Meg Thee Stallion, who I originally batted up, apparently doesn't have the choice to make music that she's not talking about busting this and busting that. She's not allowed. Why? Because the system is hiding the fact that the ancient Black Negress is due of worship and reverence. Moving on. Good on you, Pope Francis. Good up to you. Oh, he's on record stating, August 17, 2022, may the Black Madonna help guide the destiny of Europe and the world. Pope Francis. Moving on. Fifth element of culture, arts and literature. Another way civilization of people express their culture is through the field of artistic expression. This can be manifested in many ways, through dance, music, clothing, writing, design, and etc. However, in the case of ancient Kemet, the ancestors left their beautiful expression of artistic mystery not only in the form of ancient papyri, which we're about to go into, which hold a depository of historical and medical history and achievements of the Kemites, but they also left many megalithic solar structures in which are now thousands of years into the future, and we are still, as their descendants, able to appreciate and interpret through our own lens. In this segment, we will be highlighting the architectural and literary contributions that were expressed along the Nile Valley, and we will be granted the opportunity to conceive of the amount of effort as well as time it must have been taken in order to erect structures hewn in stone in the fashion that the Kemites were able to. So what we're seeing right here is the picture of the Temple of Dendera complex and the Nile Valley. This is an interior of the kings of the Temple of Karnak or Ipet-Isut, and I believe these are the columns in the Temple of Luxor. So we're just gonna go through and show you some of the architectural workings of the art and how they really look. Moving forward. Step Pyramid of Saqqara, the world's first skyscraper. Ancient Kemet is a land of many firsts, and chief among them is the distinction of being home to the world's first skyscraper. The first stone building ever constructed still stands majestically within the vast complex of the temples at Saqqara. It is called the Step Pyramid. There are a total of 15 royal pyramids at Saqqara. Most are in varying stages of disrepair, but they were all developed by the same prototype. This particular pyramid was built around 2360 before the Common Era, for the king of the third dynastic period named Djoser, who the Greeks named Djoser. His pyramid rises to a height of 197 feet in a series of six block-like steps called mastabas,
which is an Arabic word meaning mud benches. The step pyramid of Zoser represents a profound shift in the construction of the traditional tomb. In this instance, 6 mastabas were built, one on top of the other. Each of the 5 mastabas were smaller than the other one beneath it. This created a tiered structure. Tiered structure was encased in polished limestone. Thus, the first step pyramid was born. The step pyramid is but one of the several structures comprising the largest stone complex ever built under the rulership of one leader. The uniquely stylized architecture of the enclosed wall and adjoining colonnade gives the impression that you are viewing a contemporary structure, not one that was built more than 4,500 years ago. The architectural design employed at the site set the architectural standards for the next 3,000 years. The enclosure wall at the Saqqara complex was originally nearly 1,800 feet long and 900 feet wide. The wall rose to a height of over 30 feet and enclosed more than a square mile of land. Upon entering the pyramid complex of Zoser, one must walk through a colonnade consisting of 40 columns believed to represent the 40 provinces or states of early Kemet. The design of these columns is quite reminiscent of the architectural style that would later be attributed to the Greeks more than 2,000 years later. The architect Imhotep, responsible for designing the step pyramid and surrounding compound, was referred to by historians as the inventor of the building with hewn stone. The mortuary temple of Queen Hatshepsut. We now turn our attention to a structure that was once known as the finest piece of architecture ever created on the planet. Queen Hatshepsut was an African queen who reigned as the Pharaoh of Egypt in between the years 1484 and 1462 before the Common Era. This temple erected in her honor was built in the mountains of the west bank of the city of Waset, Luxor, around 1470. The original name of the temple was Zoser, which means the Holy of Holies. This structure is now called Deir el-Bahari, which was a name given to it by the Arabic communities of the general area. One might ask, why is this structure known as the Holy of Holies? To thoroughly answer that question, we would have to identify the astronomical phenomenon associated with the winter solstice and observe its relation to the mortuary temple. Now, as I was mentioning, on December 21st of each year marks a time when the sun travels the shortest path through the sky and begins lengthening of the days and shortening of the nights. Now, as I said, from December 21st to the 24th, the sun is said to be practically still every year. And on the dawn of December 25th, thousands of years before the birth of Yeshua the Christ, the sun was born. Except it wasn't born in a manger in Bethlehem, it was born at the entrance of Queen Hatshepsut's mortuary temple. Now, it begins to rise in location in the architects of the temple were able to calculate and identify, and so you will find that they have built this temple's entrance to accommodate the beaming light and the birth of the sun directly into the entrance of the holy altar of this temple, hence the name Holy of Holies. This is an aerial view of the mortuary temple of Queen Hatshepsut, and this is the Holy of Holies. Can you imagine? Wake up, you got your CMOS holy going on, shout out Motion Mineral, and you know, you're here, and all of a sudden, boom, cosmic rays, lighting you up, anointing you. They knew what they were doing. This wasn't by accident. Moving on. The Epet Hesut, the Temple of Karnak. The Temple of Karnak was the largest complex ever constructed in ancient Kemet. It is a quarter of a mile in length and consists of a series of temples built over a period of 2,000 years. At the earliest of the numerous kings, the Epet Hesut is an ancient Kemetic word which meant the most select of places, or the holiest of places, an obvious reference to the sacredness of the site. This temple also contains the largest colonnade hall ever constructed. The colonnade hall comprises of 136 columns, which stand in a row of 16. You see? Bam. Picture, screenshot, documented from Nabataean contribution to civilization. So as I read it, you can see what the temple looks like. Okay? The central aisle of the temple contains 12 columns and 12 rows, which are 69 feet high. I believe that is here. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12. 60, so how high? 69 feet high. Imagine that walking through. And keep in mind, a lot of these columns and pillars would have the heads of lotus flowers and papyrus leaves.
And what that shows you is that the builders of these megalithic structures gave reverence and acknowledged their ancestral origin of being from the Twa Umbuti. When these small Twa people were in the rainforest, you can imagine how megalithic those trees looked around them. So these columns are symbolic of the Twa Umbuti walking through and seeing the trees around them. This information was downloaded directly from Mpundishi Jehutimus. Shout out to the elder. Now, the papyrus-shaped capital adorning each of these 12 columns is large enough to accommodate a group of 100 men standing crowded atop at the same time. The Great Hall measures 338 feet in width and 170 feet in length, and the area of the floor space is equal to that of the Cathedral of Notre Dame in Paris. The English astronomer Sir Norman Lockyer discovered that the axis of this temple was accurately oriented to the summer solstice. So the mortuary temple of Hatshepsut is oriented to the winter solstice, and the temple of Karnak is oriented to the summer solstice. You can't make this stuff up. And that the colonnade hall was designed in such a manner to funnel sunlight between the two rows of columns in a manner like that of a telescope. After numerous summer visits to Egypt, Lockyer's research revealed that the sun temple of Amen-Ra at Karnak was so perfectly aligned to the summer solstice that, listen to this, a beam of light coming through a narrow passage some 50 yards all the way to a properly oriented sanctuary would remain there for no more than a couple of minutes, then pass away. What's more, it would come in a crescendo and go in a diminuendo with an observable peak at the precise solstice. This information was known by this English minister Norman Lockyer back in 1920, but now we don't know about it. So once again, you gotta keep, as I mentioned, the sun's coming in. They built this structure in a manner that funnels sunlight directly into this thing. You gotta be kidding me, man. You gotta get back to the basics. It is believed that this phenomenon allowed the astronomical priests of the temple to be able to determine the precise length of the year to within a minute, or 4 points of a decimal, 365.2422. This information comes out now by the Contributions to Civilization, page 116.
That's where they get pie
in the side. Oh, mm-hmm. The crescendo, yeah?
Yeah, like that whole, like that's pie in the side now.
Oh.
Like if you, yeah.
Bombshell. Contributions, I love it. Contributions. And this is the, this is how Temple of Luxor, the southern Epet, is represented. Now, in a certain book, it shows how they oriented these temple structures so that the columns in what would be the ribcage of the man are the actual ribcage. The Holy of Holies is in the pineal gland. So they knew what they were doing. They erected these structures with divine sacred geometry and the mastery that came from what? The Egyptian mystery systems. Moving on. Once again, Google Earth view of the Epet Isut, Temple of Karnak. This is the third time now. This is not hocus pocus. Look it up. This stuff is still sitting there, thousands of years later. Willfully, I might be hoping to take my first trip to Kemet and see if I can go down the Nile. Karnak, Saqqara, Edfu, Abydos. I'm gonna go. We'll see, man. Podcast coming soon. Literary repository of ancient Kemet. The accomplishments of the indigenous Africans of the Nile Valley as it relates to producing the world's first literary depository of various studies in their advanced forms should not be overlooked. I would like to put things into perspective very quickly by acknowledging the fact that while the Kemites had already utilized the papyrus plant in order to create the first versions of paper as far back as 2900 before the Common Era, it wasn't until over 2,000 years later that during the 8th century before the Common Era, the first written body of work was produced by the Romans known as the Iliad and the Odyssey of Homer. So we got papyruses showing medical terms and physical terms and mathematical terms, and it takes 2,000 years for the first Roman book to be produced. I want to make that very clear. We will now briefly identify some of the notable papyrus scrolls of the Kemites and highlight their contents for the viewers. What you're looking at here is a Turin papyrus. The Turin Erotic Papyrus is also known as the world's first Playboy magazine. It is also called the Erotic Papyrus, or the Turin Papyrus, and the ancient Egyptian papyrus scroll painted that was so created in the Ramses period, and it was discovered by Deir el-Medina in the 19th century. It was dubbed, as I said, the world's first men's mag, measuring 8.5 feet by 10 inches, and it was showing different sex positions, karma sutra, all kinds. So, yo, they were producing their works. the Kahun Papyrus. The Kahun Papyri are a collection of ancient Egyptian texts discussing administrative, mathematical, and medical topics in many fragments discovered by the finders of Petrie in 1889 and are kept at the University College of London. This collection of papyri is one of the largest ever found. Most of the texts are dated to 1824 before the Common Era, to the reign of Amenhennet III, in general collection of that spans the middle, around the Middle Kingdom of Kemet. The text spans through various topics, gynecological papyrus, which we'll get into, hymns, business papers, veterinarian papers. Now, birth control and abortion are well documented in ancient Kemet. The Ebers Papyrus, 1550 before the Common Era, and the Kahun Papyrus, from 1850 before the Common Era, have within them some of the earliest documented descriptions of birth control and use of honey, acacia leaves, and lint to be placed in the vagina to block the sperm. Okay? The Kahun Papyrus. Profound. Let that sink in. The first versions of birth control. Ancient Kemet. The Ebers Papyrus, 1500 before the Common Era, explores a broad range of medical science and includes chapters on the pulse, cardiovascular system, dermatology, dentistry, gynecology, osmonology, whatever that is, obstetrics, tumors, burns, fractures, intestinal disorders, and much more. There is also considerable evidence that the physicians in Kemet practiced circumcision, brain surgery, and were extremely well-versed in gynecology, as we just saw. By 2000 before the Common Era, physicians in Kemet had already created an effective organic chemical contraceptive. This product consisted of acacia spikes, honey, and dates, which were mixed in a specific ratio and inserted into the vagina. Modern science has since discovered that the acacia spikes contain lactic acid, which is a natural chemical spermicide. Pregnancy and fetal sex tests were conducted by Nile Valley physicians who soaked bags of wheat and barley in a sample of a woman's urine. Urine from a pregnant woman was known to be accelerated by the growth of certain plants. If the barley sprouted, it meant the woman was pregnant and was going to give birth to a female child. And if the wheat sprouted, it meant that she would give birth to a male child. The pregnancy test was not rediscovered by modern science until the year 1926. Thousands of years later. And the wheat barley sex determination test was not developed until 1933. Now, Valid Contributions to Civilization, page 125, Ebers Papyrus. Edwin Smith Papyrus. Edwin Smith Papyrus, the oldest medical treatise in existence, and is believed to have been written around the 18th dynasty period, around 1500 BC. In any event, the appearance of a highly sophisticated text had to have been preceded by hundreds of years of observation, research, and refinement. The ancient physician priests of Nile Valley, which have been instructed by the temples called Per Ankh, which is House of Life. Now, this papyrus describes 48 different injuries to the head, face, neck, thorax, and spinal column. The Rhind Papyrus. Much of what is known in the Nile Valley mathematics system can be found in a document called the Rhind Mathematical Papyrus, which was purchased by a man by the name of Alexander Rhind. Now, this text consists of more than 80 mathematical problems and the solutions. Some of the problems addressed in this papyrus include the surface of the sphere, the square root pi, the quadratic of the circle, and the volume of a sphere, and methods of determining the surface of circle and rectangle trapezium triangle. Thousands of years ago, our ancestors had mathematical documents. Moving on. Sixth and last element of culture. I know we're running it up and we're trying to close off class. I combine these two because we already kind of touched on the chief of state, so we don't need to really get into that again. Now, here we are approaching the end of this presentation. The last topic of pre-colonial African culture we will be highlighting is the economy of people and how the division of skilled labor aided in the progression of the dynastic periods, golden ages. In this last section, we're going to highlight a few passages out of Chikanti Diop's publication, African Origin of Civilization, where he expounds on the overall approach of the ruling party as it relates to the governance and the liberation of work to be done and capital thriving. Second last slide. As mentioned in the earliest of slides, the appointed pharaoh of Kemet during a given time was the custodian of God's land, not its owner.
and for that reason, the people had enough free access to it to continue their economic activity. It had become alienable. An individual could bequeath or sell it. Thus, the collective aspect of land ownership had become extremely theoretical. On the other hand, the state collected taxes, shrewdly assessed, except for the population of Indo-European and Indo-Aryan prisoners of war, who ended up being in servitude to the Chemites as a result of their numerous failed attempted invasions and genocides and incursions of the Hyksos and cooperating parties. Everyone worked for himself. The labor force was practically free and contractual in urban or rural communities, comparable in that respect to works in the capitalist regimes today. There was marginal capitalism with the appearance of a business class who rented land in the countryside and hired hands to cultivate it, like farmers of capitalist Europe. Their sole aim was to amass huge profits, the same business practices carried out to the other cities around the world. Now here you see just, you know, different things that might have been built by the population. And we're moving on to the last bombshell. Slave labor in Egypt? What really happened? Let's get into it. We all know the narrative we're taught. The Egyptians, tyranny, allegedly wrongfully enslaved the Hebrew population, subjugated them to indentured servitude for a period of 430 years. Well, now that we're about to close off the presentation, as you can imagine, most of the narratives that were fed by Western scholars as it relates to our ancestors simply are not true. So let's unpack this narrative and get some historical context behind it. In this last excerpt out of African Origins of Civilization, we'll be quoting for the day that we learned that the alienation of the worker in the Egyptian countryside never had more than a minor importance. The state was responsible for organizing production and achieving the optimum yield of the soil. So the division of labor on the administrative level was extremely sophisticated. It is hard to imagine today the technical efficiency that the Egyptian state organization had attained. These organization skills would have to prove to be very useful for combating the threat of the Asiatic hordes, which came from the Oxus River bend of Western Asia, as well as the Indo-European and their fellow people of the north. The end of the reign of Ramses, or his actual name, Ursa Ma'at-Ra, Tupin-Ra, as taught by Grandmaster teacher Mfundisi Jehutimus, and that of Merneptah witnessed great migrations of peoples that upset the balance around the Mediterranean and in Western Asia around the 12th century before the Common Era. Merneptah, who I mentioned before, who conquered what was now the fourth coalition and attempted genocide of the Egyptians that started back at the 17th century BC, hundreds of years before, bore the responsibility of making good use for the now over 9,000 foreigners who had to storm the land for the purposes of destruction and genocide, and a decision was made to disperse these people to the various temples of the land to express his gratitude to the gods. So to set the record straight, first and foremost, and for good, it was initially not as slaves, but as prisoners of war, of an aggravated war, which became transformed into indentured servants that the first Indo-Europeans, Indo-Aryans, and Semites, shepherd kings, the Hyksos, found themselves in Kemet. Careful study of this document could lead to no other conclusion. The African Origins of Civilization, page 212. Woo! Closing statements. So, that was profound. I did my best to unpack all of this information, and I did so because, once again, the Kiswahili term, known as the Ma'afa, our history was effectively taken from us. And for thousands of years, it's still effectively being hidden from us in these Encyclopedia Britannicas, in historical books. We are still told of narratives about this Hamitic hypothesis. Many people would suggest that the progress of the melanated community of people in this world is determined on their economic standing, or their military standing, or their health standing. From where I stand, I think what's most important is that we have a psychological reevaluation and we get back to the roots of what was carved onto each temple of the Memphite theology, which is what? Man, know thyself. So long as we don't know ourselves, everyone will continue to keep telling us who we are, where we come from, and thus will be telling us where we are allowed to go. What business do we have conceiving of notions of us being a sovereign people if we have never understood that we've been that before? On that notion, I give thanks for the opportunity to give this presentation. I want to reiterate the idea of Sankofa, Western Ghana. This staff was created by my grandfather, my ancestor, Jean Ogé, of Haitian and Cuban descent, and he showed his mastery in presenting this staff as Ogun. Taking inspiration, this is now my staff that I'm working on. One day, I'll stain and varnish it, and just as I walk with my grandfather's staff, my son will walk with mine. I want to give thanks and show all this literature, all the pyramids, and I want to show the representation also painted by, once again, my late grandfather, Jean Ogé. We see the eye of the Necheru. We see the symbolic representation of the left and right brain hemisphere and the vulture and the cobra. All in all, I share this information happily with you to show that this is not mine. None of this I am the custodian of. I am a messenger, and I am doing my work and my diligence of providing my community with the most thorough analysis of who we are, where we come from, and where we must go. And on that note, I give thanks.